We're going to start with Lakshmipathy Bhatt. So, Lakshmipathy, please welcome on stage here.
So, what was true in 1908 is still fundamentally true today. And somebody said in 1950 that nobody reads ads, people read what interests them. Sometimes it's an ad. This was an advertising practitioner called Howard Gossage in the 1950s, and you can extrapolate this to 2014 and say nobody reads ads, nobody reads blogs, nobody reads Twitter feeds, nobody reads Facebook posts. People read what interests them. Sometimes it is XYZ, email, newsletter, a Facebook post, a Twitter post, a blog post, so on and so forth. So this is fundamentally the truth that is unlikely to change for years and centuries. So whether it is a blog you're talking about, or a Facebook post, or a Twitter feed, this is the fundamental truth. So in this context, no, there is no room for your brand of dishwashing liquid, now with 30% more lime, in your target audience's mind. So whether you're a hotel brand, or a dishwashing liquid brand, or an airline, or an insurance, the hard truth is that the consumer out there in the street doesn't have time for you. What occupies their mind are the fundamental mundane things. My boss, is he going to be a pain in the ass even today? Will I get my increment? When is my child's school fees due? Will I get a promotion this year? What will be my increment? What is the price of onions? So those are the kind of mundane things that occupy a typical consumer's mind. It is not about your new campaign.
Okay.
It is not about your new Facebook post. It is not about 30% extra in your dishwashing liquid. And if you were to replace brand of dishwashing liquid with your name, same rules apply. Why should somebody read my blog versus somebody else's blog or some other content out there? Why should somebody read a corporate blog of on ERP versus reading something else? So if you were to replace a brand with a personal brand, the same rules apply. So the question is, should brands have blogs? And a deeply thought, considered expert opinion is, it depends. And this is a question that is often asked in corporate circles, in conference rooms. But I believe that's actually the wrong question. Should I have a Facebook campaign? Should I have a Twitter feed? Should I have a blog? Is not the right question to ask, in my opinion. In my view, the right question to ask is, how can we help you be more awesome? How can we as a brand help you, the consumer, be more awesome? And if you were to put yourself in the shoes of a typical consumer who follows a brand blog or a brand's Twitter feed, you ask yourself, what are you getting out of that action? Are you gaining some new insights? Is it new news? Is it pure entertainment? Yeah? So, what you get out of that particular content depends on what you're seeking. So, if the brand would start by asking, how can we help you be more awesome, that automatically translates into what they do in the product, what they do in marketing and communication, and by logic, it moves on to social media and the blog. So, should I have a brand blog at all is not the right question to ask. The right question to ask is, how can we help you, the consumer, be more awesome? So, having answered all these questions, how do I decide if my category or brand needs a blog? Now, here I'm talking from a perspective of a corporate brand or a FMCG or service brand. How do I decide if my category or brand needs a blog? Some pointers, no hard rules here. First off, are you operating in a category where the consumer goes through a considered purchase, or is it a high involvement category? Now, I've had requests from very seasoned, senior, astute marketing professionals asking to have a blog set up for a 1 rupee candy. Now, there's a very little scope for that kind of a brand to have an engaging blog. of long read content, whereas it is perhaps easier if you operate in a category where like insurance or airlines or travel, that's a high involvement category, that's a considered purchase for the consumer. And or there is scope for enriching experiences after product category or brand consumption. Yeah. So typically when you go back, when you take a holiday, that's a Club Mahindra holiday or a Sterling holiday or a regular holiday, what do? You come back and post 211 photos on Facebook, right? So that is the story that you want to tell. Similarly, after consuming the product category, whether it's buying a car or buying a new laptop or a mobile phone, is it allowing you to enrich or tell a compelling story, which others talked about today? So is there scope for storytelling with your brand and your category? And there you may have a scope for a brand blog. So off the cuff, typically you could look at, you know, brands in the categories like education, technology, services, luxury, and travel having brand blogs. Some of you may have maybe already familiar with these blogs, maybe following them. You know, in the corporate IT sector, every big brand has a blog, right? Whether it's an Infosys or a Dell or an Intel, they have a very, very dedicated, serious blogging effort going to talk to CXOs abroad. And the content is about, whatever is relevant to that category, whether it's enterprise ERP or what new media, social media, they have a blog going. Similarly, in travel, you have Club Mahindra, a blog. Marriott has a blog. In services, luxury, education. Those are all right opportunities for a brand to have a blog going. So these are perhaps the low-hanging fruit, as we call it. I'm going to talk about Buffer app. You know, many of you must be familiar with Buffer app and fans of that app, and they have a fantastic blog going out there. So the question is, all this is fine. What's the brand objective, dude? What are you going to get out of it? Now, again, depending on the brand, on the market stature, marketing plans, could be anything from establishing or furthering thought leadership. So if you're in a category like IT, that could very well be an objective. You've got stiff competition going. So you could start off a blog with the objective of establishing or furthering a thought leadership. It could be relevant for an advertising agency. You know, ad agencies have to showcase their creative abilities, have to showcase their thinking abilities. So it could be a blog focusing on account planning. That could enhance the reputation of the brand as a thought leader. Or you may want to be seen as a go-to brand for the right information in the category. So if you are looking for luxury holidays, or if you're looking for off-the-beat holidays, you know, then there could be a brand that could own that space. So you could be seen as the go-to brand for the right information on a category. You could apply for a tech brand, for example. Or it could be a platform for surprising and enriching discoveries. I mean, the list goes on. So a brand can get tangible, set tangible, measurable objectives of a blog. And the next question, what do I blog about? I'm already engaging them on Facebook with stories. Yeah. But typically what happens with brands and Facebook is that, they write a post on a Friday saying, thank God it's Friday. How many likes for this? It can't get very tough writing that, you know, kind of content. So a blog has to say something different than what they say on Twitter or Facebook. And therefore, which leads to the point that each medium has an advantage, find it, use it. Twitter, for example, is great, obviously great for instant communication, many-to-many communication, customer service. Facebook is, you can comment about topical news, things that are of interest to your consumers over there, share your ads perhaps, share your new campaign, share your packaging, so on and so forth. A blog has its own strengths. So whichever medium you use, find it, use it. So what's a blog good at? Perhaps, number one, caters to a narrow, niche, involved audience. So if you're talking about, you know, somebody interested in enterprise resource planning, obviously there's a lot of wastage when it comes to a Twitter campaign or a Facebook campaign. A blog can deliver a narrow, niche, involved audience. I mentioned earlier, thought leadership stance. You want to be seen as the, you know, the guy with the gyan on a particular topic, blog is an option. Third, long form content that can suit the brand objective, whether to be useful, to be entertaining, whatever. And lastly, which is unlikely to happen in regular blogs, meaningful discussion. So a blog can deliver on all these four parameters. Some examples, I don't know whether you've seen this. This is a corporate blog of Marriott Hotel. And you see that they have used the, within quotes, CEO's stature very well. It's almost from the desk of, you know, the CEO. And it's fairly active. It is fairly, the posts are recent. And I've seen posts about, for example, how is it at the hotel lobby on a Super Bowl evening? You know, the blog talking about the kind of buzz that is there in the hotel lobby on a Super Bowl evening where the match is shown live on a giant television screen. It talks about customer service. Yeah. So it is a platform where they could talk about a hell of a lot more things differently than the typical Facebook feed or a Twitter feed. Now, I mentioned Buffer earlier. Now, I've seen a lot of outpouring of love for Buffer app on Twitter. You know, when, even when they have outages, there are posts saying that it's okay, boss, we forgive you, we love you. It's okay if you, you know, have outages or glitches, we don't mind. Where does it come from? Yes, the app, the service is useful. A lot of us, I'm sure, are using Buffer app for our tweets and so on. But where does the love come from? I suspect the love comes from guide to high quality social media sharing, what, when, and how to share. An example post from the Buffer blog. Yeah, and if you go to the blog, there are several such, you know, posts which add value to a typical social media user. This is no, you know, outright plug for Buffer as such. And then there is the Intel blog. This is an app on, I mean, sorry, this is a blog post on free-to-play games continue to dominate other app monetization models. What does it got to do with Intel? But this is for an app developer, you know, this is extremely interesting information. And again, there is no overt plug of Intel. But by doing this constantly, what they are conveying subliminally to the reader is that, hey boss, we are helping you a little bit, you know, by making your life a little bit more awesome. And that's how they gain loyalty. But the trouble is, which is often the case with most brands and most personal bloggers also, as somebody said earlier, once you pop, you can't stop. Once you've started blogging in whatever form, make it a point to be regular, at least one post a week for, you know, brand. That's a nice you know, yardstick to have, more the merrier. But if you post once in 6 months or once a year, you'll send out a very eerie signal. Tom Fishburne, the cartoonist, called it the social media ghost town. Imagine walking into this room and finding it empty and eerie versus finding it filled with people, laughter, interaction, and camaraderie. That's the difference. So when you, as a brand, if you, you know, and I've seen this so often, where they put a Twitter link on their ad, you click onto the Twitter page, you go there, last tweet, April 2012. Yeah. You go to their blog, last blog, 2013. No, January. That sends out the wrong signal. That's kind of sends a signal that you're not interested in that, you're just doing it for namke vaste. It's a, you know, a tick box approach, checklist approach, and send out a signal that it is not, it's not a welcoming situation to be. So it's an eerie signal. So do you want to be that? So therefore, before you start off on a blog, think before you leave. Do you really want to do that? Does your brand really need a blog? Are you better off doing a Facebook campaign, a Twitter feed, so on and so forth? Because if you really want to do a blog, then understand that its fundamental difference is that going to where the crowd is versus building your own nest. Most of the brands take the first approach because it's the easier thing to do. They know that now there are millions of people already on Facebook. I will go start a brand page and they will come somehow. You know, thank God it's Friday, click how many likes for this. They will, you know, somebody will click. Share a picture of, you know, Katrina Kaif, even though it's your telecom brand, you know, you will get likes. That's an easy thing to do. And similarly with Twitter. But building your own nest is a tough part. That's when you've got to be sure that you're putting out content and driving traffic to your own page. That's the tough part. So, hard work guaranteed. So whether it is writing a thought-through post about the state of the industry, something that is of relevance to the consumer, and writing regularly, it is hard work guaranteed. You have to have a talented team at this, not your regular, you know, write something on the fly kind of a Facebook post. It is hard work guaranteed. So, and experts say that it's not about what the brand says nowadays, it's about what the brand does, and we're all familiar with this statement. The example that comes to my mind immediately is Procter & Gamble. You know, 10 years ago, they could have put out a nice TVC, emotional one, you know, goose flesh stuff about how moms are great. And they could have stopped at that. But today, they are running a Thank You Mom campaign, not just an advertising campaign, but they send the moms of US athletes to the Winter Olympics, pay for their air travel, pay for their stay at the Winter Olympics, you know, so that they could watch their sons perform for their country. And of course, they have their own branding thing at those events. So it is not about just what the brand says nowadays, it's about what the brand does. And similar rules apply even for personal branding. So when you think of a personal brand, several actions and sources create your personal brand. So it could be what you've done in your career, what you've not done in your career. It could be a social presence. It could be what your friends and peers think of it. Think of yourself. And that is true of all personal brands. But in my view, a blog is uniquely placed to showcase an individual's or brand's personality in an in-depth, multifaceted manner. You know, like how, you know, to go back to what Kavi spoke about, it opened up a different personality of Kavi thanks to hearing about what his blog was. Similarly, you know, you may have a presence on Twitter, you may have a presence on Facebook, but, you know, Krish Ashok, whom you must be all following on Twitter, you know, has a personality, has a tone of manner on Twitter, but it's enhanced when we see a blog post like this. Any of you have seen this? Yeah, some of you may have seen this. A fresh and unique set of approaches to Yahoo logo design, and it's hilarious. You know, and when you read such posts on krishashok.me, in your mind, there is another facet to the personality that you already perceive to be of his on Twitter. And that brings in a unique perspective of the personal brand. So the logical question is, in this age of no attention, aren't blogs dead? Think so? Obviously not in this forum. And many people have said this, you know, who has the time to read a Twitter post? Who has the time to read a blog post? My view is, if it is interesting, there will be an audience. So whether it is, and today long form read is gaining attention. There are, you know, several apps that focus on long form content. They gather long form content and present it to you. If you're familiar with The Verge, you know, the tech blog, fantastic writing. They have a separate section on long form journalism. So similarly in other media, whether it's a Guardian or Telegraph, you know, there is an audience, there is a room, there is a niche for interesting, sorry? Yeah, so the long read is not passing. Another aside, okay. You know, the recent Super Bowl advertising campaign, the Bud Light affordable ad was 3 minutes 43 seconds. 14.62 million views. Chrysler, Bob Dylan, 2 minutes, 5.56 million views. Yeah, so we all talk about how it's impossible to go beyond 30 seconds in today's attention, span-challenged audience. But here's the proof. 3-minute commercial, 2-minute commercial, and people are watching it. So there is room for long-form content. So if marketing is about nudging consumer behavior along the consumer's path to purchase, and that's what I believe. Every element that you put out, whether it is an outdoor or a blog post or a Facebook post, it's about nudging the consumer behavior along the consumer's path to purchase. So what's in it for me question from a blog's perspective, from a brand's perspective, and a consumer's perspective is this. To the consumer, it helps you be more awesome. And to the brand, it enhances reputation, credibility, and perception. Thank you.